Hello, my name is Jesper Nedelhoff and I'm going to talk about my paper about the bipartite traveling salesman problem. In the traveling salesman problem, we are given n vertices, and between each pair of vertices, we are given a distance. In this talk, this distance will be an integer between 1 and capital W, or infinity. The goal is to find the shortest round trip that visits all the vertices once. In the example we can see here on the right hand side, I just indicated all the finite distances on the 6 vertices, and this is the shortest round trip. The clean formulation and the clear applicability of the problem make it a favorite one in theoretical computer science. And in this talk, we are going to focus at the worst case complexity of the problem. Unfortunately, the problem is NP-complete, and therefore we expect to have some wall of improvements when we try to keep improving. If we assume that P is not equal to NP, then we know that TSP cannot be solved in polynomial time, but nevertheless, it could still be solved in quasi-polynomial time or sub-exponential time, or even moderately exponential time. And when trying to get more and more improvements, we expect to hit some wall, and maybe at that moment we get some more refined understanding of the NP-completeness. There was much recent interest in similar study for related problems, in particular for the K-CNF satisfiability problem. The strong exponential time hypothesis, which says that brute force for that problem cannot be solved significantly, led to a great amount of work on fine-grained lower bounds for on the complexity of problems in the complexity class P. So now I want to survey a bit of the worst case complexity of the TSP. So already in the 1930s, Menger observed that there is an easy n factorial algorithm, and he wondered when you can do faster. 30 years later, this was solved affirmatively by Bellman and independently Held and Karp, who gave a 2 to the n to the power n square algorithm. And this dynamic programming algorithm is now a household algorithm in many undergraduate algorithms classes. 20 years later, Karp gave a 2 to the power n n squared times capital W algorithm. So this algorithm is a bit slower because there is this factor W, but it can also use quite a bit less space. So the space usage is only order W, and whereas the dynamic programming algorithm is as large as 2 to the n, the space usage that is. Then in 2010, there was a significant breakthrough by Björklund. So he showed that the problem can also be solved in 1.66 to the power n times capital W in the case that the distances are symmetric. So the distance from I to J equals the distance from J to I. And as a stepping stone towards this result, he showed that if the underlying graph of finite distances is bipartite, then the problem can even be solved in square root 2 to the power n. So the second result was a stepping stone to the first result. And bipartite here again refers to the graph that you get with finite distances. So for example, in this instance, it's just the graph that you see there. In 2013, Sigan, Krach and myself relaxed this condition to also get to the asymmetric case, and we gave this 1.89 to the power n running time, which was subsequently improved by Björklund, Kasky, and Kutis. Given all these results, one natural question is, if we want to get one natural question is, can we actually improve the algorithm by Bellman, Held, and Karp? Strictly speaking, all these algorithms we see here, they are not an improvement because there is this factor W, capital W in there, and recall that capital W can very well be exponential in the input size because it's only represented in binary. So the natural question which we try to address in this work is, can we solve the TSP problem or the symmetric TSP problem a bit faster than 2 to the n? Can we significantly improve this Bellman, Held and Karp algorithm? And this doesn't seem to be easy at all, because all these improved algorithms that we can see here with this capital W factor, they are algebraic algorithms, which means that they are counting certain objects and they inherently rely on the power of cancellation in some algebraic setting. And the objects they are counting, for example, carp, what he counted was walks of a certain distance. And if the distances are large, it's not easy to see, or it's not clear that we can actually still get a fast algorithm. For example, if you want to count walks of a certain distance, this is a Sharpe complete problem. It can be solved in pseudo polynomial time, but then we get this capital W factor, unfortunately. Okay, and so in this talk we do get some progress, but there are some caveats, unfortunately. So the result is that symmetric bipartite TSP can be solved in 1.9999 to the power n time, assuming omega is 2. So let me elaborate a bit on this. So one hope would be to actually get a faster algorithm for general TSP, but one should realize here that to do that, even if the weights are all 0 and 1, so then we have the problem of finding Hamiltonian cycles in directed graphs, even that special case at the moment is not known to be solved solvable faster than 2 to the n. So there was some very nice progress by Björklund, Kaski and Kutis, which seems that we are close to that question, but so far this is still unresolved. So solving general TSP faster than 2 to the n, one first needs to overcome that obstacle. So the bipartite case, so we only consider bipartite graphs, but as we already saw on the previous slide, also in the past, this turned out to be a very good stepping stone towards solving the general case. So in that sense, our theorem is also pretty valuable. And then there is this last assumption, omega is 2. So omega is the smallest constant such that S times S matrices can be multiplied in time S to the power omega plus little o of 1. So here you can see some progress on omega. So this assumption omega is 2, that's a highly non-trivial assumption. Sometimes this conjecture is mentioned that this is true, but it's not clear at all, and I don't even dare to say what the common consensus is at the moment of the experts. Okay, now in the remainder of the talk, I will tell you a bit about the approach taken in this paper. So there are three steps, and the first step is pretty easy. We assume that the number of vertices is even. And this can be easily done by just adding an artificial vertex. So what this achieves is that now we can think of the problem as trying to find two perfect matchings, A and B, that form a Hamiltonian cycle and minimize the sum of the total distance of the two matchings. And the distance here denotes the sum of all the distances of the edges in the matching. So again, if we look at our example, conveniently 6 is even. So if we make a tour, then the traveling salesman actually alternates between using a red edge and a yellow edge. So the tour splits in two perfect matchings, the red and the yellow one. So we could look for the minimum tour by listing all the perfect matchings in the graph, and then looking for the pair that forms a Hamiltonian cycle and has minimum total distance. But unfortunately, there can be as many as 2 to the power capital omega of n, sorry, there can be as many as n to the power capital omega of n perfect matchings, so this is way too slow. But to do this faster, what we do in the first step is the following. So we find a family calligraphic A of 2 to the n over 2 perfect matchings. And this family will be representative for all perfect matchings in the input graph. And we are going to find this set in fast enough in the claimed running time. And here we are using this assumption that we can multiply matrices in input linear time. So representative here means the following. So if we have two families of perfect matchings, calligraphic A and calligraphic A prime, then we say calligraphic A is representative for calligraphic A prime if for each perfect matching B, so this can be any perfect matching, so it doesn't even need to be in this input graph. If for each such perfect matching B, the following holds. So the minimum distance of a perfect matching A in calligraphic A that forms a Hamiltonian cycle with B is always at most the minimum distance of a perfect matching A prime in calligraphic A prime that forms a Hamiltonian cycle with B. So the intuition behind this definition is that we can, when we have a set A prime, calligraphic A prime of perfect matchings, we can always focus, we can throw away matchings in A prime to get A, calligraphic A, and we will not lose a optimal solution with this, because whenever an optimal solution was formed with some A prime and some B, then we can replace this A prime with some other A that actually lives in calligraphic A. And note that actually this will be an equality, since we assumed the subset thing here, but for us that is not important. Okay, so that is step one. And now step two is already pretty natural. So by this property of representative sets, now actually we can just restrict attention to finding two perfect matchings in calligraphic A that jointly form a Hamiltonian cycle and minimize the total distance, the sum of the distances. And this is exactly what we will do in step two in this particular running time. So note this is fast enough because the size of calligraphic A is promised to be at most 2 to the n over 2. And now I will focus in a bit more detail on step one. And a very important matrix that actually helps in both of these steps is the matchings connectivity matrix. And it's defined as follows. For every even integer n and two perfect matchings A and B of the complete graph on n vertices, the matchings connectivity matrix is defined as follows. It's called Hn. And if you look at the row indexed by A and the column indexed by B, you write the 1 if A and B together form a single Hamiltonian cycle, and 0 otherwise. So here you can see H4. So there are 3 perfect matchings on 4 elements. And you will get the complement of the identity matrix. And here you see H6. So it turns out that there are 15 perfect matchings on 6 elements. And you get this kind of structure. Okay, so why is this matrix so important? So let's again think of the problem that we are trying to solve here in terms of this matchings connectivity matrix. It just means that we are given this bunch of perfect matchings, so we can annotate all the rows with the weights that we have, and we do the same with the columns. And now this task that we had of finding two perfect matchings that form a Hamiltonian cycle of minimum weight in terms of the matrix, what we have to do is we have to go over all these ones that we see on the intersection of the orange rows and the orange columns. And for each of these ones, we're interested in the one where the associated number with the row and the plus the associated number on the column is minimum. So I believe this guy here is achieving the minimum in this particular case. So what we are trying to do directly translates in this matchings connectivity matrix. But actually, what is here the special property in this example? If you look for a while, you will actually see that in every column, the number of ones in an orange row is always even in this setting. For example, in the last column, we see 1, 2, 3, 4 number of ones, and 4 is even, of course. So what we could also say, since this holds in every column, we could say that the 5 rows that we have, they are linearly dependent over GF2. And actually, in general, it holds when you have some rows that are linearly dependent, you can always remove the row that has the largest weight, and you will get a representative set. And this is because whenever there was some perfect matching B, used, and that works with the row that was thrown away, you can always replace it with another row that also has a 1 there, since there is an even number of ones. And it will have weight that is not larger. So based on this, we are now interested in the linear algebraic properties of the matchings connectivity matrix. And it shows to have some very nice ones. So the star here means that I'm oversimplifying things a bit. So what we showed in 2013 is that Machin's connectivity matrix can be factorized in this way. So these are just the submatrices of the Machin's connectivity matrix restricted to a special set of perfect matchings. Namely, this set Pn is the set of perfect matchings of this graph here that you can see. And it's not hard to see that the cardinality of this family is only 2 to the n over 2 minus 1. And that tells us that the factorization that we have here, this factorizing matrices, they are very narrow matrices. The inner dimension is only 2 to the n over 2 minus 1. And therefore, the rank of the Machin's connectivity matrix over G of 2 is only 2 to the n over 2 minus 1. And getting back to step 1, so what we can now do to compute the representative set is that we can look at the submatrix of the Machin's connectivity matrix. And what we do here on top is we have this family P4 in this case. So this gives us this factorizing matrix H6 with all the rows and P6, which is this guy here. And what we can do is we can compute the matrix with all the rows that are in the set family of which we want to compute the representative set. And now what we can do is we can compute the row basis of this set of rows in calligraphic A. And the minimum weight row basis turns out to be a representative set of the input. So here we can see again the minimum weight row basis is where we remove this row, and then indeed we get this this set of matchings. And the output that we get in this procedure, it will always be at most 2 to the n over 2, because that is the upper bound on the rank. Yeah, so this was all in the previous paper by Botlander, Sigan, Kratsch and myself. So in this, for our particular purposes, this is not at all fast enough. And actually, in the paper itself, to do this, to find this representative set quickly, there are a lot of other things going on where we also exploit the bipartiteness, but I'm not going to go into detail on that. Okay, now let's go to step 2, which is actually the more innovative part. So it consists of step 2a, where we just get rid of the weights, so we get to an unweighted variant. I will not get into that. And in 2b, we are going to solve the unweighted variant. Specifically, one could obtain the following theorem. Given a family of perfect matchings calligraphic A, we can detect if there are two perfect matchings that form a Hamiltonian cycle in time the size of calligraphic A times 2 to the n over 2. So this is not what I promised. I promised a faster running time. But let's first do this easier running time, and then let's later improve it. So an important part here is an easy extension of Freiwald's verification of a matrix multiplication. So if you have a matrix M that is maybe claimed to be the product of L times R, then we can check this, because if we pick two vectors X and Y of the appropriate dimension, then if M is not equal to L times R, then we get some probabilistic guarantee that a certain check is going to fail. In particular, Y transpose times M times X is equal to Y transpose times L times R times X. The probability of this is at most 1 over 4. So that's something very useful to know that we will use. In particular, so what we are set to do in this problem again is we are given this family of perfect matchings, and we would like to know whether there are two perfect matchings in the family that form a Hamiltonian cycle. So we can again think of this task in terms of the Machin's connectivity matrix. So here's again the family we had before, and now they are all the ones in the family have weight zero, and the other ones have infinity. And we would just like to know whether there's actually at least one one in these intersections of the orange rows and orange columns. So that actually you could also write it as, is the submatrix of the Machin's connectivity matrix induced by the rows and columns calligraphic A? Is that the all zero matrix, or is there a non-zero somewhere? So now we can actually use Freiwald's test with the matrix M being the all zero matrix. So then what we need to do here is we need to compute Y transpose times this all zero times the matrix we would like to test times X. And now what we can use actually is the factorization M is L times R, So the factorization I taught you earlier tells us that this quantity that we have here is actually equal to what I wrote here. So here I just plugged in this factorization that I taught you before. So here again we have this special family of perfect matchings of this narrow graph that you saw. And then what the suggested algorithm is just compute this quantity as quick as you can and then output yes if what you get is non-zero. So you will get a number. If it's non-zero, you output yes, otherwise you output no. And the point is that since this was a narrow factorization, so the size of this Pn was only 2 to the n over 2, we are just doing matrix vector multiplication here, and the matrices are of size, of dimensions, the cardinality of calligraphic A, and 2 to the n over 2. And this can be easily done in time, size of calligraphic A times 2 to the n over 2. So we get back to this in a second, because there are more factorizations of the matchings connectivity matrix. So here's another one, it's called the CUT factorization, followed from a bunch of previous works. So Hn is also modulo 2 equal to Cn times Cn transposed, where Cn is defined for every subset X that contains the element n as this. So you should think of X as a CUT, and then Cn of Ax is 1 if X, if the CUT splits the matching, and 0 otherwise. And X splits A means that there is no edge in A that has exactly one end in X. So if, for example, if this is your matching, then this is a CUT that splits the matching, but this is not the CUT that splits the matching because there is this one edge that has an endpoint in A and one not in A. So that's another factorization. So let's try to compare them. So one, there are 2 to the n minus 1 CUTs. So this factorization has quite a bit larger rank. But if you look a bit more about it, the factorizing matrices in the previous matchings factorization, actually it will be very dense. Two perfect matchings have a fairly large probability that they form a Hamiltonian cycle, namely 1 over square root n. Therefore, this is a dense matching, dense matrix. But this matrix that we have here, it's very sparse. If you look at one matching, you only have one choice for every edge where to put it in the CUT if you want to split it. So there are only 2 to the n minus 1, 2 to the n over 2 minus 1 ones per row in this matching. And then if you think back in the previous slide, so if you would like to use this CUT factorization in the previous Freiwald's base template, actually we will get a even the same running time, but for a different reason, because matrix vector multiplication can also be done quickly if the matrix is very sparse. So we have these two matrices that they are, because of different reasons, they are pretty good. And now what the main contribution is of this paper is that we show that you can combine these both factorizations to get yet another factorization that we call the narrow CUT factorization. And again, if I'm simplifying here a bit, so we let Cn be all the CUTs that split some matching in the special family of matchings Pn, then there is a factorization also that is only indexed by this special family of CUTs. So the rank is kind of in between these two factorizations, but this matrix actually has only 2 to the power 0.3 n ones per row on average. So therefore, it's actually pretty good. So now if you go back to this slide, then we get this promised running time by just using the new factorization. There are some issues that one has to deal with. So to actually get this running time, one has to randomly order the vertices, and then throw away all the matchings with too many ones in the matrix, and also enumerate all the ones in the matrix cleverly. But I will not get into that. So in conclusion, the rank upper bounds imply powerful algorithms, and also for weighted problems via Gaussian elimination, as I told you. Not only the rank is actually important, but also the sparsity can be an important measure of a factorization. I want to advertise here some survey of myself in a recent fast script. So there are plenty open questions, but I will not mention them explicitly now. Thank you for your attention.